Marriage, merger in the ocean of life. What I am speaking on is from the depth of my being, all that I have understood. It is being shared with you all. When we say fana, do we really understand what does it mean? Human beings are composed of two elements. One is light, the other is body or humus. In between, there is a gap. It's like you are a four-cornered building. The four corners of that are anger, lust, greed, and attachment. In the center of these is ego sense or nafs. These constantly pull us, and when you are able to overcome anger, lust, greed, and attachment, then the center begins to disappear. Body merges in the light that is Nur, that is consciousness that you are. That is the stage of Fana. All the desires, all the attributes, the anger, lust, greed, and attachment merges into the light and disappear. And with the disappearance of that, also disappears ego. But ego is very difficult to understand. It has no physical form. Its form is very subtle. And something that which is subtle is very difficult to understand unless there is tremendous awakening in you. Merger, marriage is a merger in the ocean of life. Until the river of your life merges with the ocean of life. Ocean of life is light, and your life, which is composed of the humus and all that relates to it, the unlimited desires, you continue to remain within the desires for this, that, and all that. Unless all these desires, unless all these attachments, all these things merge into the light, there will be no meaning. And unless this happens, even if you succeed, it will be the greatest failure of life. Marriage indeed is the merger in the ocean of life. It comes to you and you are merging in that ocean of life. What is life? Is energy. Life is infinite reservoir of energy or light. You are disappearing into that energy or light. On the shore of time, infinite waves go on striking. There is no end, no beginning. Everything is just in the middle. You are a small, insignificant wave. You are an infinitesimal seed of infinite possibilities. Quite naturally, the wave wants to be the ocean, and naturally the seed wants to be the flower. There is an entire process how the wave can become ocean and the seed can become a tree. Unless seed blossoms into a flower, fulfillment is impossible. Man has an unsatiable quest to be God. Before this, there are many temporary resting points or possibilities. None of these are the ultimate outcome. In the night, you may stay at one place for rest, but never make these as your permanent resting place. Only the final destination, which is God, can be your house or resting place. God does not mean a person sitting somewhere, as has been conceived by almost all the religions. God means your ultimate possibility. God is formless, without any name, is not sitting anywhere. God is your ultimate happening, beyond which there is nothing, and there is nowhere to go. You will remain restless and disappointed and despondent until you attain to this fruition. You may become rich, you may become famous, but none of these things can ever fulfill you. Somewhere you will continue to feel something missing. No matter how hard you try to forget this, you will never succeed. In a sense, it is good that you cannot forget this. Otherwise, the seed will miss the opportunity for fruition. Unless the seed attains to its fruition, the fragrance and the fragrance merges with the infinite, fulfillment cannot happen. The seed continues its process of growth. In that process, it passes through various stages, but ultimate is the blossoming, and when the flower blossoms, its beauty and the fragrance merges with the infinite, and then there is fulfillment. Until the river of your life merges with the ocean of life, it will not attain any meaning. And unless this happens, even if you somehow succeed, it will be the greatest failure in life. Unlucky are those who consider small successes as the ultimate success. Really lucky are those who have the awareness of this. Only such a person somehow understands this, and wherever you attain success, you make that as resting place. You seek new openings in your failures. Unless you reach God, there cannot be any fulfillment. Life is energy. I keep on repeating it again and again. It comes to you in many forms. No one can see the energy, but its manifestation, when it passes through the instruments of the body, mind and intellect, we can see its manifestation. This energy has three forms. First is the seed form. In it, nothing is manifest. It is the body form. The second is the tree form, in which everything becomes manifest, yet still soul or light remains unmanifest. Last is the flower form. In this form, even the life force is manifest. Fruition happens. The petals are open now. Fragrance merges with the infinite. When life energy attains to this fruition, only then you are indeed married. Then your marriage is the fruition of love. Merger of the finite, which is the body that comes into existence, goes through various changes from birth to death, that is finite. Every moment it goes on changing. Every moment the skin, the cells keep on dying and new cells keep on taking birth. But amidst all this, there is something which is light, which is nur, which is awareness, that remains unchanged. The first stage, which is seed, it implies desire. Desire to grow. Tree implies the second stage, love. And the final stage is the flowering. A flower implies the ultimate fruition, a merger and oneness. When you are born as a seed form, full of desire or lust. Body needs lust. Love will evolve in your life only when the seed becomes a tree. When you understand the nature of anger, lust, greed, and attachment. We remain attached to this or that, but we do not understand in the deepest core that ultimately nothing remains, everything dissolves in the ocean. When all the rivers that have been turbulent dissolve in the ocean, then it is known as each river, each drop is known as ocean. It is no more identified by its, in its any other form. The moment slowly and slowly you understand the nature of desire, attachments, one day, how does attachment come? A child is born. Is the body is outcome of ovum and sperm, but that which enters the body has no control. You have no control over that. But we consider body as the ultimate and all that relates to it. Attachment comes in. I remember an incident in the life of Sufi Junnad. Junnad had a son, the only son, and he loved his son tremendously. But the son was sick. One day, he loved his son dearly. The wife thought, he cannot live without the son. If son dies, Junnad will break. One day it happened, his son got very sick and he died. When he died, Junnad went and did the cremation. He returned. She noticed as if nothing has happened to Junnad. He was in the same way. Then his wife asked, I thought that you loved your son dearly. He said, I did. But I know, I thought that you will not be able to live without him and you will break down. Junnad replied, for a moment I thought so. Then awareness or something descended. I was happy when I was alone by myself. Then you came in the life, the happiness, the process began. I became a little more happy. Then the sun came and I became even happier. Under all these stages, they were temporary. When I was alone, it was temporary. When you and I met, it was temporary. It lasted for some time until the sun was born. And now that sun is not, how can I be unhappy? Children are the gift from the divine. They come through you. And each one in this world comes as his own destiny. The world is a stage on which we come to act our parts. One who is the center of your life today, one without whose sun never rises and never sets, when things change, the one without whom sun never rose, never died, is not meaningful to you. That person does not create any ripples in you. You loved a person very dearly. Now that person is meaningless in your life. On this stage, we come to act our parts. We act as father, mother, brother, sister, many kind of relations are developed, as friend and foe. But the moment that scene is over, it has been enacted, everyone come in their normal positions. They are as normal as nothing has happened. This is why acting is one of the most beautiful dimensions of spirituality. In a movie, an actor acts many roles, and when the scene is over, there is no attachment. This seems to be very simple as far as the movie or the stage show is concerned. When it comes to life, it becomes difficult. But that which is difficult is important to understand and go beyond this. That is the whole process of a spiritual journey. As long as you are in the seed form, you are full of desires or lust. Body needs lust. Love will evolve in your life only when the seed becomes a tree. This is the mind realm and more subtle. Only then the nectar of life will ooze into your barren life. To attain to fruition is the ultimate happening. This is the highest mountain peak. Such an understanding is essential to help you understand the sutras of marriage or human relation better. The principles of male-female relation. You are body, you are mind. In fact, you are body-mind realm. And you are also something beyond these two as well. But this you know not. Body is gross. To know body, no intelligence is needed. To know body, no meditation is needed. Mind is relatively subtle. Yet you can get the glimpse of the mind. It is so because the mind is between gross and the subtle. Mind is connected both to the body and to the soul as well. From one side of the body, you do something to get a glimpse of the mind, but you never get the glimpse of the soul. To you, the soul appears to be an empty word, meaningless. When you hear the word soul, no ripples arise in you. Instead, this word creates restlessness in you. Lust or passion is associated with body. Anger and attachment are connected with the mind. Lust is gross, just like your body. The body looks for lust. Body calls for its counterpart in the other. One shore always remains incomplete without the other. Both male and female seek one another. Both male and female are complementary energies. Male and female are two shores for the life energy to flow. Between these two shores, male and female, the life energy, the water flows. Just as a river cannot flow without two shores, so too life cannot flow without the male and female energies as two shores. These are two energies that complement one another. Separate from each other, they remain despondent. Both male and female remain incomplete without each other. Just as when you are seeking these two shores outside, but remember these shores are within you. The anima, animus, the masculine and the feminine energy within you are the two shores. At a gross level, this is ascension. The union of two energies is momentary. For a moment, the two bodies merge into one another. However, this happens only for a moment. And after this union, a great despondency descends. This separation after the dissolution is painful. You think this union is all. This physical union brings separation and pain unless there is an understanding. Certainly, the union of the body is momentary happening. That which is gross cannot merge with another gross. Really, gross can never merge or meet. The two bodies merge into one another momentarily. Two pieces of iron can remain attached to one another unless they go through the process of melting, and they melt into one another to become one. Gross has its limitation. If you try to unite two blocks of ice, these can never merge into one another in their gross form. The moment two blocks of ice melt and become fluid-like, they can certainly merge into one another. Ice has a boundary. Water has no boundary. The moment you are fluid-like, all boundaries disappear. Human body is frozen like ice. It seeks lust that is frozen like ice. Lust is frozen, and mind is fluid like water. Ice has limitation. Water flows beyond boundaries. Such is the nature of love. Yet still water has limitations as well. You can mold the mind the way you want. This cannot be done with the human body. A child is born into a Hindu family. Take him to a Muslim family. Now you can condition the child, but the body cannot change. You can condition the mind of the child, but not the body. Mind will become Muslim. There is no way to change the body. That will remain connected to its original. Child may not even remember that he was once a Hindu. As far as the mind is concerned, it can become a Hindu, Muslim or Christian. Such is the freedom of the mind. Mind is fluid-like. It goes on changing each moment. Today you may like one person. Tomorrow you may not like the same person. One who was the center of your life once, one without whose sun never rose and never set, things have changed now. That person is no more significant for you. That person does not create any ripples in your being anymore. Such is the nature of the mind. Such is the understanding of those who remain within the four walls of the mind, guided by anger, lust, greed, and attachment. The fluidity of mind is unique. Human body demands lust, mind requires love. However, the fluidity of mind is unique. One moment it is fluid-like, next moment this fluidity is no more. Body can be bought, but not the mind. Body is gross. Mind is somewhat conscious. Mind has the glimpse of awareness, because light or awareness descend first to the mind, and then from the mind to the body through organs of actions and perception. However, it is just a glimpse. Mind seeks love. Mind seeks someone who is ready to sacrifice and surrender unconditionally. Mind wants to give itself to someone. When beyond the boundaries two minds meet, and that which flows between the two is love, that will attract, that which attracts below mind is lust. Yet still there is an existence beyond the mind. Beyond the mind there are no boundaries, only an infinite sky exists. Ice has melted now, water is evaporating, and as the steam rises, it disappears beyond a certain level. The soul is like a stream. You get a glimpse of it sometimes through the body and at other times through the mind. However, these glimpses are only fading examples. Who can demand the soul? The body demands another body. The union is short-lived. So, too, mind seeks another mind. The realm of the mind is still deeper. Body seeks another body. The union is short-lived. Mind can go a little further. Mind even arises. Mind even aspires to go a little far. Mind claims love to be eternal. If you have really known love, you will come to know this. Body may disappear, but love lives on. Why to seek that which is short-lived? When there is darkness, all of a sudden there is lightning. Lightning is fragile and short-lived. And after lightning, darkness deepens. In the realm of sorrow, happiness comes for a fraction of a moment, and then the sorrow and suffering becomes even more intense. Soul does not recognize love as conceived by the mind. Mind is fluid-like. Today this flows towards this one. Tomorrow its path changes, and then it loves someone else. Mind cannot be trusted beyond a certain extent. When the mind is in love, it makes promises. Promises of trust. The nature of the mind is ever changeable. It goes on changing, it is flowing. Soul seeks the eternal. The joy that overflows when soul recognizes the answering soul is the taste of devotion, harmony, oneness, and the orgasmic experience. It is a fading glimpse now. When love transcends its boundaries of finiteness, it attains a new texture and it enters the eternal realm of bliss. Thus begins the devotion. Soul has no boundaries. The reach of the body is short-lived. Mind goes a little far. Love is eternal. Through the body, lust is born. Lust is gross. Through the mind, you get the glimpse of love. Love is somewhat fluid-like. Soul seeks eternal. Light seeks light. Soul seeks the formless. Transcendence beyond the body, mind, and being is the union of formless to formless. Only formless can merge in formless. It is at this plane lovers and beloved dissolve into one another. They experience the cosmic eternal nature of the being and its oneness through two bodies. This is the state of ultimate through male-female relation. Imagine you are in a room All windows and doors are closed, no light, no breeze. No sound of the chirping of the birds can really enter within. This is how human body is. This is how you are. Now you open the doors and windows, and as soon as the doors and windows are open, the light, breeze, the sound of the birds and the fragrance of the flower enters. This is the realm of the mind. You get a glimpse of the infinite sky. This is how mind is, still you are in the mind. A little free, yet still in a cage of finiteness. Now you have decided to come out of the room. You are not getting the glimpse of the sun alone. Now entire sun is showering on you. Now the breeze is not coming to you, instant breeze surrounds you. Now you are one with the sound of the birds. You are one with the breeze. You are one with the sunlight and the rays. You are one with the entire existence. Now try to understand these sutras, the principles of marriage. Try to understand these meditatively and lovingly. Your logic will not take you into the inner realm of these sutras. It seems something is missing, and that which is missing is the beginning. And this explanation is just in the beginning. The scripture is already in the process. These are the pages from the scripture of life. This is not for those who are not yet free from the realm of the body and all that concerns the body. This is not for those who are not yet free of the body and the mind and its attributes of anger, greed, lust, and attachment. The sage, the one who is wise, leaves the two realms right there, and therefore begin these sutras. If you are not yet free from lust and all that relates to the body and also all that relates to the mind, then you are not yet ready for these sutras or commandments or the principles of male-female relation. Then you are not yet ready for transcendence. If body still interests you, then you are not ready for these. Still the search for the ultimate has not begun. Still if you are either the body or the mind, then you cannot understand these sutras. I am not interested in your words that you want to know the secrets. I can see all that is going on within. This does not mean that these sutras are for the older ones. These are for the one who has reached the last realm in the process of transformation. Sometimes a person can attain to maturity even in his youth. Suddenly a child jumps from the seed stage and becomes a tree. The question is of awareness, not age or anything else. Therefore, these secrets of sex. These sutras are not any definition or description. It is like one who has tasted the sweet fruit. What will he do? He will enjoy. He will go on narrating to others. He may start singing the glory. You will try to correlate your experience with those who have experienced themselves. It is like you want to enter the temple, yet still you have not yet entered the temple. This is an effort to bring the taste of the being in the temple of those who have not yet been to the temple. For such people, there can be no definition. Definition can only happen between those who know. Therefore, this explanation is needed. definition can complete in a sentence or so, but the explanation is something different. Explanation is always longer, and through explanation we only give a glimpse. Explanation is true to some extent, and to some extent it is not. It is so because when a learned one speaks to an ignorant one, he speaks the language that he can understand. When a Buddha has to speak to those who have not yet attained to enlightenment, he has to use the language. If Buddha uses the language, then he cannot make his message understood. In order to make the people understand, the master has to use the language of the people. Then it can no more remain a definition. Instead, it becomes an explanation. Therefore, because of intense desire to know the secrets of sex and marriage, I begin the explanation. The first narration explains sex as the outmost expression of love through the body. Sex is the outmost expression of love through the body. I had explained earlier, lust is the beginning of the journey, and ultimate flowering is love. Through lust, one day you reach to love, and then love gives you the wings to soar in the infinite sky. But to reach to the ultimate in sex, you have to pass through love. For this, devotion is the tool. Tantra worships the female as deity because it is through this deity in togetherness you are aspiring to attain the ultimate. This is why love is given importance. On one side of love is lust, and on the other side is transcendence. Love connects both lust and the ultimate. If any explanation is to be given of lust, love has to be the way. And also, if ultimate has to be defined, love has to be the medium once again. Love is between the two. Love bridges both lust and ultimate. Love is the balance between the two. If those who have known the secrets of sex have to explain these secrets to the one who does not know, love has to be the way. Love has to be the language. Then, besides love, there can be no other way. Nothing can be said about lust. Also, nothing can be said about the ultimate either. Love is the only thing that we can speak. In love, lust still remains to some extent. However, in ultimate, lust is no more. In lust, there is traces of love. That is why one remains entangled in lust. Maybe there is even 1% of love in lust, and this 1% renders a new texture to lust. This 1% love gives a new expression to lust and hides its ugliness and gives an indication of its utility. Both lust and love are connected to one another. Therefore, love is not pure. There is still a trace of lust in it. When lust leans towards love, it gets defiled. And when love leans towards lust, it gets sanctified. Love lends its nature to lust. Only this much is for today. I keep on speaking on these topics in many ways from different angles. I am not interested in any metaphysical questions or abstract questions. For me, you are important, and how to bring the transformation and take you to that state that you can experience the same oceanic oneness is my way.